Hello everyone. Today I'm going to talk about a very basic but a very important topic in the field of psychology. Okay. For psychologists, to understand the human behavior, they need to know the basics also. Okay, how does human behavior occur? How do we react to the environment? How do we talk to our friends? Okay, how do we make sense of everything around us? Okay, so to know that, we need to focus on the basics. And what are the basics from which we can know how human behavior is affected? That is through understanding the process of sensation and perception. Okay. Now, what is sensation? Sensation can be like, you know, if we talk about sensation, the first thing that comes in our mind is there are five types of senses, right? Vision, touch, smell, taste, and hearing. We just limit ourselves to those five types of senses. But we have found that not only there are only five types of senses, there are dozens of senses that help us in perceiving the world. Perceiving the world means understanding the world. Okay. So first we'll focus on what is sensation. Okay. And then we'll move further to the perception. Sensation encompasses the process by which our sense organs receives information from the environment. So basically, sensation is the very first step for us to connect to the environment. In the sense here, environment means the world around us. So sensation is the very first step that connects us to the world. Okay. So we sense, we hear, we see, we feel, we touch. Okay. We feel the pressure, we feel the pain, we feel the temperature. We feel the movement, the vibrations, all these are types of sensations that help us to understand the world around us. Okay. So here what happens is that psychologists have found various types, not only five are there, there are dozens of senses that help us in making sense of the world around us. Okay. So there is something called as kinesthesis. Okay. What is kinesthesis? It is a type of sense that we all have. Okay, that help us to know our own body movements, okay, our own muscle movements, the pain, the tension in the muscles. Okay, when we are moving, it helps us to know that we are moving. Okay, when there is a car or something approaching us, it tells us to move away. Okay, the sense, the first thing is, if I approach towards the moving car, I'll meet with an accident, so better I move aside. Okay, so this type of information given to us is called as kinesthesis. Okay, so then you have another type of sense called as vestibular sense that helps us in understanding the movement. Is it our head that is moving, that is making the movement around, or is it the real things in the environment that are moving? Because we have to make judgment also, right? If we can't judge that, okay, this is the car moving or this is my body or head moving, then it will be very difficult for us to walk on the roads. Isn't it? So we have not only five, but various types of other important senses that help us, okay, in organizing the world. Okay. So now, how do we experience the senses? There is something called as physical energy emitted by the environment. Light energy, power energy, audible energies. So all these energies, when they are getting connected to our brain, okay, those energies, those physical sources of energies are called as stimulus or stimuli. So these stimuli help us in making sensations. Okay. So the stimuli or the stimulus can be of various types and can be of various intensity. Okay. So what are the various types of stimuli that we have? Light energy. Okay. Light helps us to see. So the light affects our sensation of vision. Okay. So that is one type of energy, that is one stimuli. Okay. Then we have audible energy, the sound, the music piece, the car's noise or the TV or the radio or whatever is playing around. That energy is interpreted our brain as in the form of audition. Okay. Then we have heat, cold. Those are also types of energies that make us feel, okay, now it is cold, I should wear a sweater. Okay, now it's very hot, I should have some cold drinks to have, isn't it? So we have various types of stimulus that affects our sensation. Then we have various intensities of stimulus. Intensity means how strong the stimulus has to be. We'll be coming on that in absolute threshold. The strength of the stimulus also affects our sensation. Like, how much perfume should I put so that friends around me or people around me can smell the perfume? Okay, if I put only little bit, the strength or the intensity is very less, only I can smell it. But if I put a lot, the whole building or the whole people will be smelling it and they'll get headaches, isn't it? So here the intensity and the types of stimulus effects are sensation. Now this study of sensation was done in the field of psychophysics. In psychology, we have various subfields, and there is a very popular field of psychology called as psychophysics that studies the connection between physical energy and its psychological interpretation by the human being. The physical energy that is there in the environment, how we interpret it. So if the sun is very strong, okay, we'll feel a lot of heat, okay. Some of us may feel drowsy, some of us may feel like very weak, or some of us may be on the verge of fainting. So what are all those? Physical energy, sun, and the psychological interpretation by us feeling heat or feeling drowsy. Okay. So here in psychophysics, we try to study the connection between physical energy and the psychological reaction to that. And it's a very important field of psychology. It studies the types of sensations that we go through. Now here we will focus on some types of important factors, okay, that lead us to sense. How do we sense the things around us? Okay, how do we smell? How do we hear? How do we see? Okay, how do we do that? So there is certain basic principles, okay, within us, within the environment, that lead us to make the first sensation that we have. Okay. So basically sensation is what? It is the first step towards connecting with the environment. Then how do we do the connection? It's through a process called as absolute threshold. Absolute threshold means detecting what's out there. The intensity, the strength, how much strength or how much minimum intensity we require to have a sensation, the first sensation. When does a stimulus become strong enough for us to detect? And that detection can be done through a process called as absolute threshold. Now, what is absolute threshold? Absolute threshold is the smallest intensity of a stimulus that must be present for it to be detected. Okay, it's the smallest, the minimum requirement for us to detect anything. Okay, so we have various senses and we'll see the minimum amount of intensity we require to detect those senses. Okay, so for sight, for vision, what is the minimum quantity we require to see the thing? A candle flame can be seen from 30 miles away on a dark, clean night. That is our minimum quantity of stimulus strength we require to see the candle flame. Then for hearing, the ticking of a watch can be heard 20 feet away under quiet condition. Ticking of the clock, you can hear it from 20 feet away, but the environment has to be very silent. Okay? Then taste, sugar can be tasted when 1 teaspoon is dissolved in 2 gallons of water. 2 gallons of water, a lot of water, right? But still you can taste sugar when it is 1 teaspoon. So you require at least 1 teaspoon of sugar to get its taste, okay? Smell, perfume can be detected when 1 drop is present in 3-room apartment. So minimum requirement for perfume to be detected, for our senses of smell to be working, is 1 drop. But the environment has to be completely pollution free, okay? And for touch, a bee's wing falling from a distance of 1 centimeter can be felt on the cheek. Bee's wing, very, very thin, small bees, their wings are, you know, very light. But if they fall from 1 centimeter on our cheek, we can feel it, okay? So all these are sense organs: hearing, vision, smell, touch, okay? All these, they require minimum amount of intensity to work, okay? And that minimum amount of intensity is called as absolute threshold. Now, we have very nicely defined absolute threshold for all of us. If our thresholds are more sensitive than this, okay, it will be very difficult for us to make senses of the whole world around us, because like if it is much more sensitive, if we are very sensitive, many times, you know, many people are sensitive to various types of odors, smells, okay, and that is why they have allergy. Many people go through allergies, okay, little bit of dust or little bit of anything, they have allergy. Okay, so if our senses, they are well balanced, whatever minimum absolute threshold we have, that is good. If we have lesser than that, if we are more sensitive than that, then we will be into us only. We will be hearing all the ribbling and tickling inside us, okay, and we will have no time to listen to the environment around us. Okay, so you must be knowing that there are high frequency wavelengths, hearing, vision and everything, that are away from human capacity. There are lower wavelengths also and higher wavelengths also. So we are in a frame where we can very comfortably make sense of ourselves and the world. If we are more sensitive than this, it will be like we will be into ourselves, and if we are like not at all sensitive to any of our senses, then finished. Okay, we won't be making any detection, we won't be seeing anything in front of us, the car coming, still not seeing, and crash. Okay, so the amount of absolute threshold we have is very good. Now one more thing, the examples that I gave, okay, you need to have one drop of perfume in 3-bedroom apartment, or you need to have the bee's wing falling on you from a distance of 1 centimeter, okay, or a vision of, you know, from 30 miles away, a candlelight vision. All these are ideal conditions, isn't it? You always don't have all the, you know, all your, the 30 miles away, clean, clear, no noise pollution, no vision disturbance. You don't have it like that, okay? Or in the bedroom or 3-room apartment, you don't have, you are not the only one staying there. There'll be many people around, isn't it? So in ideal situation and in practical real situation, there is a difference. We have something called as noise pollution. Now here, noise pollution does not mean only the audible pollution, okay, not only loud noise. Here noise pollution, we are considering the crowd also, okay, we are considering the fogginess, we are considering the disturbances of distance, we are considering the noise, everything. Suppose somebody is calling you in the party, so there your absolute threshold has to be higher, okay, because in practical life you don't have a noise free environment. Okay, you have a lot of noises, lot of pollution coming in, okay, so you have to be extra sensitive, okay, your absolute threshold has to be higher to detect the sensitive differences, okay. So this is how we require the minimum amount of, you know, suppose like there is lot of noise going on, okay, so your friend has to really shout in order to make you hear him or her, okay. When it's a noise free situation like this, okay, even a minor ticking of the clock you can hear, of your watch, hand watch, isn't it? So it depends, like in the environment, what kind of environment you are, and according to that environment, the type of threshold you require to do the sensation. Then we have another important thing that is called as differential threshold or difference threshold. Noticing distinctions between stimuli. Now here what happens, I'll give you a situation and then explain you what is differential threshold, okay. First the situation is, suppose you have gone to the market, you do shopping, right? So what is the favorite thing you will do shopping? Clothes or clothes, okay. So clothes means, yeah, they are everyone's favorite, okay. Now you go for shopping, just now Diwali, you have done your shopping, right? And you see a lot of options available in the market, isn't it? So what happens is that, which one to choose that comes within your budget? There are a lot of nice dresses within the same budget that you have, okay? So which one to take? So what will you do? First, you'll start rejecting the things that you don't like, the color, the design, the things and all, okay? At the end, ultimately, you'll come to 2 or 3 dresses that you like the best, okay? And after that stage, it's like, you know, whichever dress you take, you're happy with that, you know, you're not like, okay, I left that, oh, that was more nice. You have reached a point whereby you see no more difference, okay, and you select a dress. So once you select a dress, it's like, okay, I'm happy with this, this is the best I have selected, okay. So here what is happening, you are reducing the options, okay, to the best possible preference of yours, okay. So on the same line, we have differential threshold. It's the just noticeable difference that we require to detect anything in the environment, okay. So what is differential threshold? Difference threshold is the smallest level of stimulation required to sense that a change in the stimulation has occurred, or it's the just noticeable difference, just noticeable difference, okay. So, yeah, you're having a cup of tea, you like a very sweet tea, okay. So, suppose like, you know, there has been 2 spoons of sugar in your tea, okay. So, you want more sweet. So, how much of sweetness you require? You will say, okay, I want it to be very, very sweet, extra, extra sweet. So, you will put 4 more teaspoons of sugar into it, okay. And then the difference that you get, okay, that will be your differential threshold because you have a sweet tooth. Now, people who do not have a sweet tooth, for them even half a teaspoon of sugar in the tea is like too much. Oh my God, it is so sweet, isn't it? So, here what happens is that differential threshold again differs from individual to individual. So, this differential threshold actually help us to make distinction between two stimulus, between two objects, okay. So, this principle has been very well projected by a law, okay, called as Weber's law. Weber's law states that a just noticeable difference is a constant proportion of the intensity of an initial stimulus. So, there is always a constant proportion going on to detect the difference between two stimulus. According to Weber's law, the constant proportion is 1:50. First, you have to know the original value, original weight of the stimulus. Then how much of change will lead you to identify the changes will tell your differential threshold. I'll give an example. First, you take something, any fruit, any vegetable in your hand, that is of 50 ounce. So, how much of more weight will make you experience the difference in the weight? According to Weber's law, it's 1 ounce. So, if you make 0.05 grams of change in the vegetable or in the whatever thing you are holding, it won't make any change. But if you make a 1 ounce difference in your thing that you are holding, then you will experience, yeah, there is some increase in weight. And that is the proportion or the ratio is same for higher level of weight also. Okay. So, if you are weighing a 500 ounce of something, so how much noticeable amount of weight you require to know the change happening? 10 ounce. 10:500 is equal to 1:50. So, you can see the same thing happening in general life also. When you are in a very crowded situation, you need a higher amount of noise or sound from your friend to call you. Okay. And you can see like when you are sitting in a quiet room, suppose you are studying, okay, and the telephone bell rings, okay, because the environment is very quiet. So, the original level of sound is very less. So, little bit of sound also, telephone ringing also is a huge impact. But when you are in a very crowded situation, you many times don't even hear the telephone ring. So, to hear the telephone ring in a crowded situation, the telephone ring has to be something of temple bell ringing. That has to be of that intensity for you to hear, okay. Many times you are traveling in the bus or traveling in traffic, okay, and then you reach home and then you see so many missed calls of your friend. You call up, sorry, I couldn't hear, there was a lot of noise. What is that? Because you could not detect the differential threshold because there was already the original noise was very loud. So, this is called as sensation, the basic principles of sensation. Now, we will focus on a theory that is like a little bit slightly deviating from what we have been talking about, okay. This is a modern psychophysical theory. It has been developed by Green and Sweat, and the theory's name is theory of signal detection. Till now, it is like, you know, only environment giving us the information and we are taking it. That is what we have been studying. But in this theory, they basically talk about the equal contribution of man and the environment. Till now, it is like only environment giving us and we are taking the senses. But in this theory, they talk that, okay, we have senses, okay, sensory experience and non-sensory experience, and it is both equal participation of the observer and the environment. So, it is not only the environment always giving the information, it is us also who are receiving it and interpreting it. So, we have certain context given by Buckout related to the theory, same theory of signal detection, how we detect the signal. What is signal detection? It means senses. okay, senses detection, how we detect the signal in our environment. Okay, we do it through four ways. Okay, first way is called as hit response. Okay, signal, that is the stimulus, is present and the subject is successful in identifying the signal. So when you are walking on the road, you see a speedy bike coming towards you, you move away, that is a hit response. You correctly identified it. Then you have miss response. The subject misses to identify the presence of a signal. So the same situation, you are walking on the road, the speedy bike coming towards you, you miss, you don't pay attention, you are on the phone or something, hitting, okay, maybe an accident, by God's grace, maybe a little bit of injury and you are safe, okay. But what is happening here, you are missing the signal detection. Then the third is false alarm response. In a trial, the signal is absent, but the subject identifies the same as present. Here the hit is incorrect or false. There is no signal, but still you experience the signal. It happens mostly in psychological ways, like, you know, when you are very anxious about your results. Okay, you have written your exam and you are very anxious about your results. So your results will be coming in paper. So anybody says any paper, huh, what paper, where paper, results have come out. Okay, any friend saying some other result, some cricket match result, football result, you hear the word result, oh, exam results have come out. So what is happening here? The false alarm response. Okay, there is no signal about your exam results. Okay, still, because you are so anxious about it, you often think about. Then the last one is correct rejection. In a trial, the signal is not present and the subject also identifies the signal as absent. That is, the presence of stimulus is correctly rejected. It's like correct rejection. The signal is not there and you are also identifying it correctly. Okay, that is called as correct rejection. Now, based on this hits and misses that we do, okay, we hit on the target, make a correct detection of the signal, or we miss by mistake, okay, these help us to make the senses around the world. Okay, many times they help us, many times they may create problem for us also. Like, yeah, in the case of horror movies, okay, if there is no signal, still you are catching all the ghostly signals, then it's a problem for you only. Okay, you'll keep on crying, shouting, running here and there, and people will think you are mad or stuff like that. Okay, so here, based on the hits and misses, we make sense about our environment. Okay, so in this theory, we are detecting the signals and making sensations about it. Okay. And the next very important topic in this sensation is called as sensory adaptation. Sensory adaptation, turning down our responses. The basic means turning down our responses. Okay. So sensory adaptation is an adjustment in sensory capability following prolonged exposure to the stimuli. Okay, it's adaptation. Our senses also make compromises or adaptations. Okay, again, giving you a scene, you enter a hotel room or you enter any place, public place, and there in the beginning you get a very strong puff of cigarette, smell of cigarette. You can't take it. It's very strong. Okay, but after 5-10 minutes, you adjust to that, isn't it? When you come out of your home on the road, the pollution is very strong. We keep handkerchief or anything. But after 5-10 minutes, we remove the handkerchief. We are walking very comfortably. So what is happening here? Our senses are adapting to the environment. Okay, so one way it is good, and in some ways it is not very good for us also. Okay, we are always very comfortably adapting to the pollution, and we know what are the side effects of pollution. Okay, but in one way we need to adapt, otherwise, you know, our bodies, the mechanism of our body will immediately give up. So here, sensory adaptation, why does it occur? See, when something is going on continuously at the same pace, our brain stops receiving information. Okay, the brain only receives information when there is a big change in the environment. Okay, so what happens, like you are getting bored in my lecture because monotonous, I'm talking in the same pace. Okay, you'll start, you know, getting bored and then sleepy and sleep. Okay, how suddenly you'll wake up from in the class? When I shout. So there is a big change. So what is happening when my monotonous speaking is going on? You are adapting to it, you are falling asleep. Okay, and when there is a big change, if I shout, you'll wake up, oh yes ma'am, I'm hearing you. And if still I'm continuing the same monotonous thing, you'll have a very good sleep, good day sleep, okay? Don't have to sleep at night. So here what happens is that sensory adaptation, in the brain continuously receives information from the environment, okay? And when the information is slow and going in the constant same pace, okay, the brain stops receiving it. It's like same information, why to take it long? Okay, if I lecture you 3-4 classes about the same thing, will you pay attention to that? Why to take the same information, isn't it? So you stop receiving it. Same thing done by the environment, but done by the brain. Why to take the same information again? When there is some difference, I'll take it. Okay, so this sensory adaptation occurs through a process called as transduction. Now the physical energy that is present in our environment has to be changed into a nervous system activity. Okay, so like, you know, how in computer, whatever information, whatever language is decoded into various codes, they have various codes now, okay, digitalized codes, okay, the computer decodes the information, we write something like some information, some software we make, but in the computer the chips are very coded, they have their own mechanism, okay, then the coded information is interpreted by the computer, okay, brain of the computer, and then it transfers the information to us in the form of our language. The same thing is done by our brain. The brain first decodes the information, the physical energy, into nervous system activity, okay, neural codes, we call them neural codes, okay, and that process of changing the physical energy into nervous system activity is called as transduction. And how does the transduction occur? First, anything, you are hearing a music piece, or you are looking at a movie, okay, that those are physical energies, okay, that go to transduction at the reception. So when you are watching a movie, what is the reception point? Your eyes. When you are hearing a music, what is your reception point? Ears, okay. So the information will first go to the eyes, then it will be converted into electrical energies or electrical potentials. The information, the images of the movie, will be changed into electrical impulses from our eyes, and then it will go to the generator potential nerve impulse. It will generate information in the form of electrical energy, and then it will go to the nerve activity in the nervous system. Okay, so we have electrical impulses in ourselves. Those impulses, those codes actually help us in understanding the world. So these nerve activity then are coded into afferent code. Afferent codes are nothing, they are the impulses, like you are hearing the dialogue of your favorite hero, okay, and that information is converted into electrical energy by our brain, and that information goes to our brain through nervous system, okay, and is interpreted in the form of, okay, it's a dialogue. But let me tell you, we don't pay attention to it because it's so automatic and so quick. He's saying we are listening. So just imagine the way our brain functions. It's so fast, doesn't even take milliseconds or whatever to interpret it, okay? But when you break the process down in understanding how our brain works, whoa, it's a big phenomena. Maybe we can never reach to that level. What is computer? It has been developed on the ideals of our brain, isn't it? But I would say computer has not reached even 1% of what its brain capacity is, isn't it? So here, what happens, all this process I'm talking about in slow manner, but they happen very quickly within our brain, okay? So all this differential threshold, absolute threshold, okay, signal detection, okay, sensory adaptation, they, what do? They help us in making sense about the world. And if there is any kind of problem in making sense about the world, it affects us physically, mentally, psychologically, in every possible way, okay? So sensation is the first stage, okay, to make understanding about the world. Then we have later stages called as attention and perception, which we'll be looking into the next topics.